Welcome to the Indo News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy. These are the news articles chosen for today's discussion. They are given along with the page number of different editions. Link for the handwritten notes in PDF format and the timestamping for the discussed articles are given in the description box as well as the comment section for the benefit of the mobile viewers.
First, let us see past prelims questions. See, past prelims questions are very important. They help us to understand the approach of the exam. So whenever you have trouble filtering information or you have doubts regarding priority areas, you can go through past prelims questions. They will guide you. Now let us solve few 2020 prelims questions. First question. Consider the following statements. 36% of India's districts are classified as overexploited or critical by the Central Groundwater Authority, CGWA. Second statement. CGWA was formed under Environment Protection Act. Third statement. India is the largest area under groundwater irrigation in the world. Which of the statements are correct? So, in order to understand the first statement, we need to know a report called Dynamic Groundwater Resources Assessment. See, the Central Groundwater Body periodically assess the groundwater resources in India. This is done in collaboration with state and union territories. And based on that data, it publishes a report called Dynamic Groundwater Resource Assessment. In this report, the Central Groundwater Body categorizes assessment units depending on stage of groundwater extraction. In this case, the assessment units can be districts, taluk, mandals. The name varies from place to place. So, according to this assessment, an area can belong in any one of the four categories. For example, an area can belong in overexploited category, it can belong in critical category, it can belong in semi-critical category, it can belong in safe category, based on stage of groundwater extraction. Since the first statement in the question is about overexploited and critical category, let us see about them. First, let us take overexploited category. See, overexploited category means if the stage of groundwater extraction is greater than 100%. Whereas critical category means the stage of groundwater extraction is greater than 90% but less than 100%. So, based on the 2017 national compilation, we can see that 1186 assessed units were in overexploited category. This is 17% of assessed units, okay? And we can see 313 assessed units are in critical category. This is approximately 5% of assessed units. So, in total, 22% is in overexploited and critical category. But the first statement in question says 36% of India's districts are classified as overexploited or critical. So, this statement is wrong. Now, let us move on to the second statement. CGWA was formed under the Environment Protection Act. This statement is correct. See, the Central Groundwater Authority is a statutory body. It was established under Section 3(3) of Environment Protection Act 1986. The main objective of CGWA is to regulate and control the groundwater development and management in the country. So, the second statement is right. Moving on to the third statement. India has the largest area under groundwater irrigation in the world. This statement is also correct. See, according to a research paper of Food and Agriculture Organization, FAO, India has the largest extent of area under groundwater irrigation. This area is approximately 39 million hectares. So, in conclusion, the first statement is wrong, second statement is correct, third statement is correct. So, the answer is B, 2 and 3 only. See, there is a technique called elimination technique which can be used in prelims. This technique will better your guesses, it will improve your accuracy, it will also help you to take calculated risk in prelims. This technique is used by toppers to narrow down their guesses. So, let us apply this technique to this question. See, in this question, we have three statements. Now, let us take up the first statement. The first statement is about overexploited and critical areas. See, to be frank, it is a tough statement to assess because one has to know the exact data in the report to get it right. So, for time being, let us keep the statement at a side and let us move on to the second one. The second statement is regarding the Environment Protection Act. See, this statement is easy to assess because if you are following the current affairs regularly, you will know that CGWA was established under Environment Protection Act. So, obviously, you know the statement is correct. Only two options have second statement in them. It is B, 2 and 3 only, and C, 2 only. So, the answer can be either option B or option C. So, without knowing the data in the first statement, we have completely eliminated the first statement. This is called elimination technique. So whenever you're practicing prelims questions, even if you're not sure about the answer, try to apply this technique to narrow down the guesses. It will increase your accuracy and boost your score. Now let us move on to the second question. This is a prelims question asked in 2020. Which of the following are the most likely places to find the musk deer in its natural habitat? First place, Ascot Wildlife Sanctuary. Second place, Gangotri National Park. Third place, Kishanpur Wildlife Sanctuary. Fourth place, Manas National Park. Select the correct answer using the code given below. First, let us see about Himalayan musk deer. See, the Himalayan musk deer is locally known as Kasturi Mrig. It is found in the forested areas between 2500 meters and the tree line. See, the Himalayan musk deer is adapted for living in alpine, subalpine and upper temperate habitats, that is greater than 2500 meters. So it is mostly found in cold areas. So the Himalayan musk deer are usually found in high altitude ecosystem in the colder part of Himalayas. For example, it is found in Nanda Devi National Park, Valley of Flowers National Park, Gangotri National Park, Kedarnath Wildlife Sanctuary, Govind Wildlife Sanctuary, Ascot Wildlife Sanctuary and many other protected areas. Most of these protected areas are found in Uttarakhand. Now coming back to the question, we are given four places. See, the third place, Kishanpur Wildlife Sanctuary, is in Uttar Pradesh. So it does not belong to a high altitude cold ecosystem. So we can eliminate this option. So option B and option C is eliminated. Now we have A, 1 and 2 only, and D, 1 and 4 only. Of these two options, now let us take Manas National Park, the fourth place. See, Manas National Park is in Assam. It is located at a height of 61 meters above sea level. So it is a low altitude ecosystem. As we have already discussed, Himalayan musk deer occurs in high altitude cold ecosystem. So we can eliminate this fourth place, Manas National Park. Hence the option D, 1 and 4 only is eliminated. So only one option remains, that is A, 1 and 2 only. The Himalayan musk deer is found in Ascot Wildlife Sanctuary and Gangotri National Park. The answer is A, 1 and 2 only. Now let us move on to the third question. With reference to India's biodiversity, Ceylon frogmouth, coppersmith barbet, great chin minivet and white-throated red start are birds, primates, reptiles, amphibians. These are the options given. See, the answer is A, birds. See, these kind of questions are direct questions. So they are tough to guess. You can't apply elimination technique in these questions. Only if you know the species mentioned in the question, you can attend it accurately. Now let us see about these birds mentioned in the question. The first bird is Sri Lanka frogmouth or Ceylon frogmouth. The picture of the bird is displayed here. From the picture we can see it is an odd cryptic looking bird. It is more like a cross between an owl and a nightjar. It has wide mouth and proportionally smaller eyes. Now let us move on to the second bird. Coppersmith barbet. See, coppersmith barbet is a small bird with streaked underparts and a well-patterned face. As you can see from this picture, this bird has a red forehead with yellow shades around the eyes and throat. It is an attractive bright colored bird. Now let us move on to the next one. Grey chin minivet. See, grey chin minivet is a songbird usually found in mountain forests. Mountain forest means forest found in mountainous region. See, the great chin minivet is a small long-tailed bird. It is usually vocal, active and encountered in large flocks. The males of this species have a bright orange belly and a comma-shaped slash on the wing. This can be observed in the picture given here. You can see the bright orange belly in the picture and a comma-shaped slash on the wing. This is a unique feature of this bird. Now let us move on to the next one. The next bird is white-throated redstart. As the name says, both the male and female of this species have a white throat. This can be observed in the picture given here. See, from the picture you can see there's a white throat and we can also observe a long white stripe on the wings. These birds also have a flashing orange rump. Rump is nothing but the underbelly part of the bird. And from the picture we can also see a dark tail. The male of this species usually have a black face and a deep orange belly. This can be seen in the picture. Now let us move on to the next question. With reference to the period of Gupta dynasty, the towns Gantasala, Kadura and Chaul were well known as option A, ports handling foreign trade, option B, capitals of powerful kingdoms, option C, places of exquisite stone art and architecture, option D, important Buddhist pilgrimage centers. The answer is option A, ports handling foreign trade. See, India has a 5,000 years history of maritime activity. During this 5,000 years, India has played a major role in commerce and cultural interaction between the East and West. In India, we have evidence of shipbuilding, port and warehouse installation since the Harappan culture times. So, it is important to learn about the ports and trade centers during the ancient times. Now, let us see some important Harappan ports. They are Lothal, Kinderkera, Kuntasi and Megam. There were also important ports during Mauryas and Gupta period. Let us see about them. The important ports during this period are Supara, Kalyana, Semilla, Mandagore, Malizigara, Muzuris. These ports were found on the west coast. Now let us see the ports on the east coast. They were Charitrapur, Paluru, Dantapur, Kalingapattanam, Gantasala, Puhar and Kemara. So make note of these ports. UPSC likes to ask questions about ports and trade centers during the ancient and medieval times. So you can use this information to solve the questions. With this, we have come to the end of past prelims questions discussion. See, solving past prelims questions is very important to clearing prelims. The mantra to clear prelims is 50% preparation and 50% practice. So keep on practicing prelims questions. It will improve your accuracy and will boost your score. Now let us move on to article discussion. Now let us take up this article. This is about Indian Premier League 2021. See, the BCCI has suspended the Indian Premier League 2021 amid cases of COVID-19. BCCI stands for Board of Control for Cricket in India. See, the BCCI was hopeful of conducting IPL by using biosecure bubbles. So what are biosecure bubbles? See, a biosecure bubble is an environment which is cut off from the outside world. Everyone engaged in the tournament, including the players, support staff and match officials, will be limited only to a few places. The point of bio bubble is to minimize the risk of contracting the infection through limited contact from outside world. So it is a secured space. There is a key element in the bio bubble. See, in a bio bubble, the players will not be permitted to have access to families, visitors, friends and relatives for the duration of the entire tournament. So the cricketers will not be permitted to pay a visit to family or friends outside the team's biosecure environment. See, the bio bubble is essential for the sporting world in this pandemic era. The sporting world has managed to overcome the COVID-19 pandemic by conducting various tournaments through bio bubbles. For example, last year Indian Premier League, US Open and National Basketball Association conducted various tournaments using this strategy. During these tournaments, the bio bubble created a sanitized area which can be accessed only by a certain set of people who are not infected with virus. See, international sports require a lot of frequent air travels. So, bio bubbles are essential to create a safe environment for players. But this mechanism has received a lot of criticism from sport personalities. According to these experts, these bio bubbles will have huge psychological impacts on sportspersons, since they are isolated from their support structure like family, friends, relatives. Now let us see how a bio bubble works. See, the bubble is a part of hotel and the stadium. The procedure to enter a bio bubble is like this. A player before leaving the country must clear the RT-PCR test. RT-PCR test is conducted for detecting COVID-19. Again at the destination, the player will be tested again for COVID-19. Apart from this test, regular tests will be conducted throughout the tournament for detection of COVID-19. Also in this IPL, additional technologies were used to make the bio bubble secure. For example, in 2021 IPL, every player was supposed to wear a special Bluetooth band on their wrist. This Bluetooth band will sound an alarm if a player breached the biosecure bubble. Also, it was mandatory for the players' families to wear this Bluetooth band who are in the bio bubble. See, several sections of the society opposed this edition of IPL due to the present situation in India. The author of this article says that BCCI should have conducted the tournament in UAE like last time. 2020 IPL was conducted in UAE. See, UAE is a safer location because it is a small country where majority of the citizens have been vaccinated. Since UAE is a small country, it also requires minimum air travels. So UAE would have been a better option to conduct IPL. But BCCI conducted IPL in India to show the world that we are ready to host World T20 in coming October. This was a grave mistake, according to the author. With this, we have come to the end of the discussion. In this article, we saw about the working of biosecure bubble and also the reason for IPL postponement. Now, let us move on to the next article. Now look at this article. According to this article, the Department of Telecommunications, DOT, gave permission to telecom service providers to conduct trials for the use and application of 5G technology. But Chinese companies like Huawei and ZTE were left out from the trials. So in this context, let us discuss about the evolution of mobile communication with special focus on 4G and 5G technology. The syllabus for reference is displayed on the screen. Aspirants can go through it. See, the cellular networks are getting an upgrade with the arrival of 5th generation or 5G technology. With 5G, consumers can expect new applications and improved user experience. What is 5G? 5G stands for 5th generation of mobile communication. The 5G promises consumers faster data rates with low latencies or delays in transmitting data. Now let us see the chronology of mobile communication. First came the 1G, that is first generation. The first generation was about wireless calling. It eliminated the need for phone cords and copper wiring, enabling network calls on the go. So the first generation gave the concept of mobile phones. The first generation can be seen as an evolution from landlines to mobile phones, but it had many drawbacks. The 1G was only a voice service. It had poor battery life and poor voice quality. Next came the 2G, that is the second generation. The 2G came with messaging, that is SMS. The second generation mobile communication replaced analog with a digital network. The 2G enabled call and text encryption, text messaging and multimedia messaging. This was an important upgradation. Then came the 3G, that is third generation. Third generation came with internet and video. Third generation enabled full-feature mobile internet access and video calling with faster data transmission speeds. Next came 4G or fourth generation. See, the fourth generation of broadband cellular network was popularly referred to as Magic 2. The Magic 2 stands for Mobile Multimedia Anywhere Global Mobility Solutions over Integrated Wireless and Customized Services. See, a 4G network enabled a mobile device to exchange data at a rate of 100 Mbps for high mobility communication and at a rate of 1 Gbps for low mobility communication. Also, there are multiple 4G mobile technology standards used by different cellular providers. This includes LTE pre-4G, LTE Advanced, WiMAX and Ultra Mobile Broadband, UMB. For example, LTE or Long Term Evolution is sometimes called as 3.9G or Super 3G. This Super 3G aims to accomplish higher speeds along with lower packet latency. So far we have discussed about 1G, 2G, 3G and 4G. See, in 10 years, the internet traffic demand will increase significantly and we will have more than 100 billion connections of Internet of Things. So we require next level of technology to counter such demands. Also, the consumer demands high-speed data at lower prices. To provide solution to all these problems, 5G has been evolved. See, 5G has been labeled as ultra-fast, ultra-reliable, ultra-high capacity transmitting at super low latency. What is the difference between 4G and 5G? See, the 5G technology can provide higher data speeds with less delay than 4G. 5G services can also provide coverage areas with data speeds up to 100 times faster and almost instantaneous response time. Let us see this with an example. For example, with 4G, it may take 6 minutes to download a full feature film. But with 5G, the same movie can be downloaded in 15 seconds. This is a great upgradation in speed. See, the current 4G speeds are approximately 12 to 36 megabytes per second, Mbps. While 5G services are expected to support speed of 300 Mbps or greater. The key differences between 4G and 5G are illustrated in the figure. You can go through it. Now let us talk about the 5G initiatives of India. See, the government of India has launched a program titled Building an End-to-End 5G Testbed in 2018. This program aims to advance innovation and research in 5G. It envisages close collaboration between the universities and small technology companies to build proof of concept 5G prototypes. Also in 2018, Ericsson has installed the first public access 5G testbed at IIT Delhi. This testbed aims at developing applications in the broadband and low latency areas, which will provide access to the industry and institution to work on India-specific usage scenarios and applications. With this, we have come to the end of the discussion. In this discussion, we saw about 5G, the evolution of mobile communication technology, and 5G initiatives in India. Now, let us move on to the next article. See, the second wave of COVID-19 pandemic is causing heavy damages to people's lives. Also, the demand for medical oxygen is on the rise, and several states are struggling to keep pace with demand. In this context, this news article reports about the device called concentrators. See, the oxygen concentrators can be used as a solution to control the rising demand for medical oxygen. But before discussing the device, let us know some facts related to blood saturation levels. See, the blood oxygen levels indicate the oxygen level present in the blood that flows through the arteries of the body. The blood oxygen level can be measured using an instrument called pulse oximeter. The normal oxygen level in the pulse oximeter usually ranges between 95% to 100%. But due to COVID-19, blood oxygen level in the body can drop below 90%. This oxygen level is considered as low and the condition is called as hypoxemia. Hypoxemia is caused due to decreased capacity of the body to take in oxygen. In COVID-19 patients, poor condition of lungs is a major reason for hypoxemia. Now let us discuss about oxygen concentrator. See, oxygen concentrators are external device that supply oxygen to ease the burden on the lungs. Concentrators are device that can be operated at home. See, the medical oxygen sourced from industrial units are supplied via cylinders. It can be only operated in hospital which have special devices. This shortcoming can be overcome by using an oxygen concentrator which can be operated in home. The concentrator works by plugging into a source of electricity. This device helps those whose saturation level ranges between 88 to 92%. This is the important point. But for levels even lower than that, more intense oxygenation is required, for which this device is incapable. In those situations, only hospitals can help those patients. See, the oxygen concentrator takes in air and separates the oxygen. That is how it works. It delivers the oxygen into a person via a nasal cannula. Nasal cannula is nothing but a device that consists of a lightweight tube which are placed in the nostrils and from which a mixture of air and oxygen flows. The oxygen concentrator delivers air that is up to 95% oxygen. Now let us understand its working. A concentrator consists of a compressor and a sieve bed filter. The compressor squeezes and adjusts the pressure of atmospheric air, whereas the sieve bed, which is made of zeolite material, is used for separating the nitrogen in atmospheric air. This device consists of two sieve beds that work to release oxygen into a tank that is connected to the nasal cannula. See, the oxygen concentrator comes with different specifications. There is a pulse flow concentrator which uses sensors to deliver oxygen. While there is also continuous flow concentrator which delivers oxygen at a constant level. Finally, the article concludes that the use of concentrator could help in increasing the supply of medical oxygen required for COVID-19 patients. Now let us move on to the next article. Now look at this news article. It is related to geotagging. See, according to this article, Thiruvananthapuram Corporation is planning to use geotagging to track COVID positive cases in the city. So in this context, let us learn few relevant facts about geotagging. See, science and technology is an important part of prelims. Lot of technology based questions are frequently asked in prelims. For example, past year, a question was asked about drone technology. So learning the basics of technology and its working will help you to boost the score. Now let us see about geotagging. The syllabus relevant to this article is displayed on the screen. Aspirants can go through it. What is geotagging? See, geotagging is adding some geographical information to a media form. The media form can be a digital photograph, it can be a video, or it can be even a SMS message. Let me explain this concept with an example. For example, imagine a digital photograph. In that photograph, a person is sitting near a lake. To this photograph, you can add geographical information. For example, you can add the latitude and longitude coordinates of the lake. You can add the altitude of the lake. You can add the timestamp during which the photo was taken. You can add the accuracy data to the photo. You can also add the location name to the photograph. This is called geotagging, adding of geographical information to a media. Another example is Instagram. See, in Instagram, when we post a photo or video, the location will be automatically added to the post. This is also an example of geotagging. What are the technical requirements for geotagging? See, geotagging is a very simple process. It requires only a smartphone and a location service. With geotagging, we can tag anything which can be linked to a space. We can tag trees, we can tag rivers, we can tag man-made assets like monuments, buildings. We can even tag natural events like flood, cyclones, or man-made events like festivals, activities. The potential is vast. Because of its vast potential, geotagging is used in decision-making process. It is also used in time, wealth, and asset management. See, currently, geotagging is used in variety of fields, ranging from social media to public works. It is also used in various government schemes and programs. For example, geotagging is used in NREGA scheme, that is Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Act. It is used in Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana Gramin scheme. It is used in Pradhan Mantri Gram Sadak Yojana scheme. It is also used for toilet construction under Swachh Bharat. It is also used for building of highways and urban housing. The first scheme to experiment with geotagging was NREGA scheme. See, in NREGA scheme, around 90% of the assets have been geotagged. Similarly, geotagging is also used by Ministry of Jal Shakti. The Ministry of Jal Shakti has launched a mobile application for geotagging projects under Pradhan Mantri Krishi Sinchai Yojana. So we can see the potential of geotagging is very vast, and it is used in various fields, it is used in various schemes, it has a lot of positives. But there are some few drawbacks when it comes to geotagging. The geotagging requires proper internet connection and adequate knowledge for its functioning. But in India, we have unpredictable internet connections and there is a lack of adequate knowledge at the ground levels. This has proved to be a major hurdle in implementing geotagging. Now, coming back to the news article. See, the geotagging method was already used after the first outbreak of COVID-19. It was used to prevent the quarantined people from venturing out. Now, once again, due to the increase in positive cases and difficulty in tracking people, the Thiruvananthapuram Corporation has planned to resume the geotagging process. See, under this process, the coordinators will call up the COVID positive patients and get their exact address. After getting the address, the corporation's volunteer team will visit the house and feed the location details into the geotagging application. This will help the corporation to track the COVID-19 patients and will also help the corporation to study the pattern of disease spread. So that is the end of this discussion. In this discussion, we saw about geotagging, its working, and also its usage in various fields. With this information, now let us move on to the next article. Have a look at this news article. The pandemic doesn't seem to be sparing the Asiatic lions as well. See, about 8 big cats have tested positive in the Nehru Zoological Park in Hyderabad. The officials got suspicious of the infection after the felines displayed breathing distress. On subjecting them to RT-PCR test, they tested positive for COVID. Soon, CT will also be done to assess the degree of infection. So, in the above context, let us see about these big cats and the Nehru Zoological Park. Now, let us see some key facts regarding Asiatic lion. Common name, Asiatic lion. Scientific name, Panthera leo persica. Population, 523. Height, approximately 110 cm. Length, 200 to 280 cm. Weight, 110 to 190 kg. Status, this is very important. Asiatic lion is listed in Schedule 1 of Wildlife Protection Act. It is also in Appendix 1 of CITES. It is also endangered on IUCN Red List. This is the key point. See, Asiatic lions are slightly smaller than African lions. In African lions, the males tend to live with the females. But in Asiatic lions, the males do not live with females of their pride. Pride is a group of lions. It is a collective noun. In Asiatic lions, the female lions are the pride's primary hunters. They often work together to prey upon a large mammal. See, these animals are magnificent. The Asiatic lions have a longitudinal fold of skin running along its belly. It is the most striking morphological character of Asiatic lions. This character is rarely seen in African lions. The fur of Asiatic lion ranges in color from ruddy tawny, heavily speckled with black, to sandy or buff green, sometimes with a silvery sheen in certain lights. Ruddy tawny is a color which is similar to reddish brown. The average life of Asiatic lion is 16 to 18 years. See, the Asiatic lions once prowled from Middle East to India. Now, sadly, only a fraction of these magnificent animals survive in the wild. There are only several hundred Asiatic lions in the world, and they live only in the Gir forest in India. To understand it better, it is an area that is smaller than Greater London. These lions occupy remnant forest habitats in the two hill system of Gir and Girnar that comprises Gujarat's largest tracts of dry deciduous forest, thorny forest and savanna. According to WWF, there are 523 Asiatic lions in the world. Owing to the threat and decline in population, we have scheduled the Asiatic lions in Schedule 1 of Wildlife Protection Act. Also, IUCN marks it endangered, while the sites has kept it in Appendix 1. Now let us have a quick glimpse into the Nehru Zoological Park. See, the Nehru Zoological Park is located in Hyderabad, Telangana. It is one of the most expansive zoo park in Asia. The park is home to more than 1,500 species of birds, animals and reptiles. This park hosts different species such as mynas, white peacocks, African elephants, chimpanzees and rhinoceros. The major attraction for visitors within the zoo is the lion safari. See, a van fenced with iron will take you through the gates of the safari. There are 4 female and 4 male Asiatic lions in their premises. So that is the end of this discussion. In this discussion, we saw about Asiatic lions and Nehru Zoological Park. Now let us move on to the next article. Now let us discuss this news article from the World page. This article is regarding G7. So in this discussion, we'll cover the article and we'll also discuss about G7 from the exam point of view. The syllabus relevant to the article is displayed on the screen. Aspirants can go through it. See, the G7 foreign ministers' first in-person talks were held for the first time in 2 years. During this meet, the G7 countries discussed how to form a common front towards an increasingly assertive China. This meet was hosted by Britain. See, Britain is holding the G7 presidency for this year. Also, India, Australia and South Korea were also invited to participate in the summit. This was in line with the US call for deeper alliance. During this meet, the G7 countries pushed for a robust cooperation in pressuring China over the Xinjiang region. See, the Xinjiang region is a far west province of China which is seeing unrest because of Uyghur population. See, the China is accused of committing human rights violation against Uyghurs in this region. This issue was brought up in the summit. Besides this issue, the issue of Hong Kong was also taken up for discussion. See, the Hong Kong protest is always making news. So let us take a quick detour to understand the history better. Far back in 1898, following the Opium War, Britain entered a 99-year lease with China to get Hong Kong. This lease ended in 1997. After termination of the lease, the Britain returned Hong Kong to China as a special administrative region, SAR. See, under the doctrine of one country, two system, China allowed the Hong Kong to continue to govern itself and maintain many independent system for a period of 50 years, till 2047. See, Hong Kong and mainland China are practically two different countries. For example, Hong Kong economy is characterized by low tax rates, free trade and less government interference. Hong Kong politically is also more democratic. This is because of the Western influence. Whereas mainland China is more conservative and restrictive. Because of these differences, Hong Kong was given a special administrative region status. But recently, China has increased its influence on Hong Kong through legal framework. This has created a lot of protest in the region. And the China's handling of the issue has invited criticism from the world leaders. So back to the article. This dubious handling of Hong Kong protest was also taken up for discussion during the G7 meet. Besides these topics, the group also discussed the cooperation on climate change issues. See, as we saw, the member nation stands unified in their idea against China. But their stand differed in the ways of expressing their opinion. For instance, Japan has historic tensions with China, but refrain from taking any aggressive posturing to avoid blowing up of confrontations. On the other hand, Italy has been seen as one of the most Beijing-friendly nations in the West. This is because Italy in 2009 signed up for Belt and Road Initiative with China. But during this meet, Italy took a strong stand against China regarding the Uyghurs. So all these things happened in G7 foreign ministers meet. Now let us see what is G7. This is important. See, the G7 or group of 7 are Canada, France, Germany, Italy, Japan, United Kingdom and United States. It is an intergovernmental organization that was formed in 1975 by the top economies of that time. See, the G7 is an informal forum. It was formed to discuss the pressing world issues. Canada joined the group in 1976, and the European Union began attending the G7 summits from 1977. See, initially, the G7 was formed to discuss economic issues. But in the later years, G7 deliberated about several challenges over the decades. For example, it deliberated about oil crashes of 1970s, the economic changeover of ex-Soviet bloc nations, and many pressing issues such as financial crisis, terrorism, arms control, and drug trafficking. The G7 became G8 when Russia joined in 1997. This is important. But the group returned back to G7 after Russia was expelled as a member in 2014. This is because Russia annexed Crimea region of Ukraine. So Russia was expelled from G8 as a punishment. As we saw earlier, the G7 is informal. So G7 does not have a formal constitution or a fixed headquarters. The decision taken by the leaders during the annual summits are non-binding. See, in the recent years, the G7 has lost its relevance. This is because of rise of India, China and Brazil over the past few decades. The G7 share in global GDP has now fallen to around 40%. So G7 is losing its relevance in recent years. We have seen about G7, now let us see about G20. The G20 is important because India is a member of G20. See, G20 is a large group of countries and also includes the G7 members. See, the G20 was formed in 1999 to bring more countries on board to address global economic concerns. G20 has a global GDP share of 80%. But the problem with G20 is it only discusses economic challenges and issues, whereas G7 discusses a plethora of global challenges. That is the end of the discussion. In this discussion, we saw about G7, the outcome of recent G7 meet, and we also discussed about G20 in brief. Now let us move on to practice prelims questions. The first question. With reference to G7 countries, consider the following statements. First statement. Russia is a member of G7. Second statement. G7 countries discuss economic, environmental and political issues. Third statement. The headquarters of G7 is in Florence, Italy. Which of the statements given above are correct? See, the first statement is a wrong statement. Russia was a member of G8, not G7. It was expelled from G8 in 2014 and now the organization is called G7. This was discussed in the article. Now let us move on to the second statement. This statement is correct. G7 has a wide mandate and it discusses on various topics. So it is the correct statement. Now moving on to the third statement. Headquarters of G7 is in Florence, Italy. This statement is wrong. See, G7 has no headquarters. It is an informal organization. This was also discussed in the article. So the answer is D2 only. Only second statement is correct. First and third are wrong statement. Now let us move on to the second question. With reference to Asiatic lions, consider the following statements. The first statement. One walking through the Panna National Park can spot these lions. Second statement. The Asiatic lions are listed endangered in IUCN Red List. Third statement. Asiatic lions are facing habitat loss. Which of the statements given above are correct? Now let us take the first statement. One walking through the Panna National Park can spot these lions. This statement is wrong. See, as we saw in the discussion, Asiatic lions are only found in Gir area in Gujarat. So we can eliminate the first statement. Moving on to the second statement. The Asiatic lions are listed endangered in IUCN Red List. This statement is correct. We have discussed this statement in the article. Now moving on to the third statement. Asiatic lions are facing habitat loss. This statement is also correct. So the correct answer is option C, 2 and 3 only. That is, only second and third statement are correct. First statement is wrong. Now let us move on to the third question. Consider the following statements with respect to oxygen concentrators. First statement. Oxygen concentrators operate by drawing air from the environment to deliver continuous, clean and concentrated oxygen. Second statement. They have high reliability and are low cost compared with oxygen cylinders and piped oxygen supply system. Third statement. They need for regular, although minimal, maintenance and reliable power supply. Which of the above given statements are correct? See, the answer is D, 1, 2 and 3. All the given three statements are correct. We have discussed all these points in the article. So the answer is D, 1, 2 and 3.
Mains practice questions are displayed here. You can write your answer and post in the comment section below. With this, we have come to the end of Indo News Analysis. If you like this video, don't forget to click like, share and comment. Subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy channel for more UPSC updates. Thank you.